Good evening, and welcome to another Bible study here on Wednesday night at Hurricane Baptist Church. We're into our study on the book of Acts. Remember, the book of Acts is that bridge between the Gospels and the letters to the church. And in fact, we talked last week about the birth of the church. We're in chapter 2, and verse number 5 we'll be starting with tonight as we start this fifth lesson in this study. We've covered all about the ascension of Christ, and as we get into this fifth chapter, we're going to see what's happening now. The Pentecost is here, and they have one accord. We've heard the wind, and we're going to get into more of that right now. So let's go to Acts chapter 2 and verse number 5. And there were, dwelling at Jerusalem, Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. So we see this gathering of Jews from every nation, devout from every nation. They were celebrating the Feast of First Fruits. And remember, that's when the crops first started coming in. It was like the first part of June. And that was one of those of the feasts that they talk about back over in the Old Testament. This is in Numbers 28, verses 25 and 26, if you want to look it up and see what it's about. Devout means to be reverent, worshipful, careful. So here are these men, they're gathered together. They brought together to this big celebration. And now in verse number 6, and now when this was noised about abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. So when you look at verse number 6 there, you see that noised about, and there's two different thoughts on that noised about. One is that the noise of the wind coming in, the sound of the wind, was enough that was heard all over. And so people heard it and come to see what was going on. The other school of thought is that because of what the disciples were saying, the apostles were saying with the tongues, that's what brought people in. So either way, God brought them together. It's the Feast of the Weeks, and He brings them all together then so that they can hear this going on. So we're going to see this first time of witnessing. We're going to see this first outreach of these men as they try to reach these people for Christ. So we're going to look at what happened here. So it was noise, the sound of the blast. It brought people to the scene. We look at it that way. And now in verses 6, 8, and 11, we see what was going on here. It says that every man heard them speak in his own language. In verse number 8, we'll skip down to there. How hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? Verse 9, Parthians and Medes and Elamites and dwellers of Mesopotamia and in Judea and Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia and Phrygia and Pamphylia and Egypt and in parts of Libya and Cyrene, strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes. Verse 11, Cretes and Arabians who do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. So we see all these different nationalities are brought together, and they hear them speaking in their own tongue. Remember last week we talked about tongues, and these weren't ecstatic utterances. These were actual literal tongues. And we just read all those different languages, these different groups of people like the Medes and those from Judea and Cappadocia and so forth, and all these different nationalities. They come together. They're Jews, and they come together, and they hear this message in their own tongue, and they're amazed. They're amazed. If we was to go back up there into the verse number 7, and they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And they weren't looked upon as being the higher intellect. And he says, what's going on? They were amazed. Can you imagine that? You see these group of men standing up there, and all of a sudden they start speaking all these different languages, and each man is listening to it in his own tongue. So this is the birth of the church, and this is the power of the Holy Spirit's come down. Remember what was going to happen. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But we had the power of the Holy Spirit come in. We had that sound. We had the tongues. And we see that looks like a flame, but it's just a bright, luminous thing. This one tongue, and then it was split in different pieces and different things, and then went over each one of them. So we see that power of the Holy Spirit. They were able to hear listen to this now. The wonderful works of God. It wasn't just a bunch of gibberish. They wasn't just talking to be talking. No, they heard the wonderful works of God. So what would they be hearing? They'd be hearing about the personal witness of the gospel, about the good news. Peter's going to preach a message here pretty soon. We're getting into that, the first big sermon. And we see that, but the gathering, how God brings these all together and allows them to hear in their own language. So they can understand. And see, that's what, when we talk to people about the gospel, When we share the gospel, now most of us, we talk to other Christians or talk to other people in our English. Some speak in Spanish and some a foreign language. Most of us, we speak in English. But even when we're speaking English, we want to be careful that we use language that people understand. Use words that they can understand. Okay, we don't get a super spiritual and try to use big Bible words and that. That's the sanctification and the justifications, all those kind of things. Those that are outside the Bible don't understand that. So what we want to do is, as these people did here, they spoke in tongues that people could understand the wonderful works of God, what God had already accomplished through His Son. So we look at that and then go back to, going down to verses 12 and 13. And they were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, what meaneth this? What is this all about? And others, verse 13, mocking, said, these men are full of new wine. They're drunk, basically what they were saying. They drank too much wine. And so, but they were amazed. And they said, what's this about? Now, they heard what was being said. But what was all this, the loud noise, the tongues, all these things happening? What could this be? If you could just put yourself there. Just stop and think about what that would be like. The group of the women and the men and the apostles, and they were all gathered around in this room, in this home, and all of a sudden, boom, all this noise starts in, and this tongue appears, and just to be there would be kind of overwhelming. They were expecting the Holy Spirit to show up, but they didn't know how He was going to show up. Jesus didn't say, now you could wait down there, and He said the Holy Spirit's going to come, but He didn't say it'd be sound like a big rushing wind, or there'd be tongues of fire looking like fire. He didn't say anything about that. So they had to adjust to that, and we don't have a time frame here, how long it took some of these things to happen, but we know that it took a while for them to realize what was going on. And as the Spirit was, they were filled with the Spirit, and they started pouring out all this different languages and this message to the people. And so we see what happened. There was some received it, and others rejected it. Verse 13, they mocked it. They made fun of it. And that's the same thing that happens today. You know, you can talk to someone about the Lord Jesus Christ. Ask, are you a Christian? No, I'm not a Christian. Well, can I share with you some words from the Bible? Can I share with you? And they say, okay, go ahead. And so you give them the plan of salvation. You're a sinner. You're condemned in your sin. But Jesus Christ, God loved you so much, He sent His Son to die on a cross for your sins. And you give them the gospel. And some say, yes. But most of them say, no. They reject it. Over in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2, he says this, for he saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in a day of salvation have I succored thee, or I've helped you, I've kept you, thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. And see, that's the message. We have the gospel message, but this is the time. It's not to be put off. It's not to be pushed away. These men are hearing the gospel, and they're hearing this good, wonderful works of God in their own language, but they can't accept it. They can't believe it. I want to read one other portion of Scripture to you. It's over in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I didn't mark my Bible for that. Just a second. I'll be there. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And it was verse 18. And it says this. He says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. Why doesn't everybody, when they hear the gospel, put their faith and trust in Christ? Because the loss to them is foolishness, but unto us, which are saved, it is the power of God. So we have to be careful when we share the gospel. And that's what he's getting ready to. Peter's going to give a message here. And this message he's going to give them talks about who Jesus Christ is, about God's plan and how it all come together and how what their part was in it. This is a great sermon right here that he's going to preach in a moment. But the idea is that people, when they hear those words, they have a tendency to reject them to start with. But then we have the power of the Holy Spirit that can come in, and that's what we're counting on. You and I can't get anybody saved, but the power of the Holy Spirit, when it comes, it can make the difference. So here they are, they're mocking. Some are listening to it, and others are mocking it. Verse 14, we're going to see some witnessing go on now. We're going to hear his message. And he says here, but Peter, standing up with the 11, lift up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell in Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. So what's he saying? He says, listen to what I got to say. For he says, these are not, verse 15, for these are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing that it is but the third hour of the day, or 9 o'clock in the morning. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. So we're just going to stop there a second. We see Peter. Remember Peter? Remember when the trial was going on and what did Peter do? He said, let me get in here with you, Lord. I'll stand with you. I'm not going to leave. No, he didn't, did he? He said, I don't know who that is. Leave me alone. I don't know who it is. I'll shut up. I don't know who it is. Three times he denied him. This is Peter now. Peter standing up in front of all of these people. Some are believing and some aren't believing. Some are accepting, some are rejecting. And they're kind of making fun of them, saying they're mocking, saying they're drunk. But Peter, now the difference in Peter now is what? He's indwelled by the Holy Spirit, isn't he? We just read that a little bit earlier in the first part of this chapter. He's indwelled by the Holy Spirit of God. So he now has boldness. And see, by that same Spirit, we can have boldness too. We can stand up in front of people and share the gospel. And I've heard people say, I can't do it. Yeah, you can do it, but you won't do it. The problem is we can. We have within us, we have the Word of God, and we have the Spirit of God, so you can share the gospel. If nothing else, you can tell people what God has done for you. What happened? Here's what I was, here's what happened, and here's what I became. And you can fill in the blanks in between there, but those three things, that's your testimony. And you can share with them. And so Peter, he's there and he's preaching now. He's got a boldness. He's standing up with the 11 and they're preaching before 4,000 of people. And so we're going to see in verse number 17 now. He said, this was prophesied by Joel in verse 16. And it shall come to pass in the last days. Okay, the last days actually started. Christ is born. And the last days is from when he was born till he comes back. So we're going from back, if you look at first part of Matthew, first part of Luke, from there all the way to the 19th chapter of Revelation. That's all the last days. Okay, and he said that the last days, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. He said, I'm going to pour out my Spirit on all flesh. That means that the Holy Spirit's going to come out. It's going to be on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. So we see this great event. So what we have in here, we see this prophecy. It begins the last days of earth's history, the last days of God's work on earth. Go a little bit further, it's the final age of God's plan for human history. And it begins the dispensation of God's grace, the church age, the age of the gospel. This pouring out, as we see here, these last days of the pour out the Spirit, he sends forth his Spirit to dwell in every believer. Remember what he's come from over in, let's back up a little bit over into John chapter 14 and verse 17. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. That was the promise. Remember, that's what happened when the Holy Spirit came in at the first part of this chapter. And we read where he came in and he indwelled each believer from that day on. When people put their faith and trust in Christ, they were indwelled by the Holy Spirit all the way up to today. It happens today and it'll happen until the return of Christ. When a person puts their faith and trust in Christ, they're indwelled by the Holy Spirit of God. He is with you. And he shall be in you. He's going to pour out his Spirit on them. He says here, he's going to abide with us. Remember that same verse talks about him abiding. He's with us and he's in us. Can't have much more company than that, much more a feeling of a presence than that when we can see that he's with us and he's in us. Just stop and think about it just a second. What if you could look over and see the Holy Spirit sitting right here beside you? What would that do? If you could just look over and see the Holy Spirit's right beside you. You know, it would be just to know that he's there, but to be able to see him. We can't see him, but we know that he's a spirit, and he's with us, and he's in us. And that's the promise of this day and time. And he says he's going to fill every believer. It says over in Ephesians 5:18, you know, don't be drunk with wine or controlled with wine, but be controlled, be filled with the Spirit. The word filled has the idea of being controlled. It's not the idea of filling up a cup. It's the idea that you're controlled by that Holy Spirit. And then we see here the very special manifestations of Christ to the believer. So we over here in the same chapter in verse 21 in John 14, he said, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him, reveal myself to him. So this is what's all taking place right now, to fulfill this promises, this prophecy of Joel. He's going to pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Again, when we look at this now, just to get bring this down for you. Prophecy is proclaiming and predicting the truth. It's when we take prophesying today, okay? When I take the Bible and I teach it, I proclaim the truth of the Word of God. I'm not telling you what's going to happen 100 years from now or 1,000 years from now. I'm telling you what the Bible says today. All right, so that's the prophesying that we're talking about there. He says we're going to have going to be dreaming. We're going to have dreams. There's going to be the flesh. He's going to pour His Spirit out on all flesh. I'll get myself here together. And your sons and daughters of prophets are going to teach. Your young men shall see visions. Okay, these things are coming. And again, I want you to be aware. When we see the visions and see the dreams, I have people come up from time to time and say, I had a dream, or I heard somebody had a dream, or they saw something. And so, what do you think? That's the first thing. What do you think? First of all, I don't know all the circumstances of what they're talking about, but I know that I take the Word of God, and I measure what they're telling me according to the Word of God. When people talk about all these different gifts of the Spirit and how they're the healing, the tongues, and all these things, how does that match up with the Word of God? Okay, so that's what we always want to do. And these things aren't happening yet. Okay, we're going to see that it's going to happen in the future. But this is the beginning of the unfolding of the prophecy of Joel, and he comes right out of over in the Psalms. And he says that he's going to pour out his spirit, or Joel, excuse me, out of Joel. And he says, and on my servants and on my handmaids, I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. So what the idea is here, that it don't make any difference who you are. As a Christian now, it doesn't make any difference if you're a man, you're a woman, you're old, you're young. It's when you get saved, it's what he's telling us right there. He said that on my handmaids, I'm going to pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy, they shall teach. So we see as God is working in these last days, and again, this is a prophecy that's unfolding. And all of it hasn't happened yet. And we can see that as we get down here a little bit further. All of it hasn't happened yet. But they're going to see these appearances. They're going to see visions, have dreams. But that's in the future. You know, I made a note here as I was making an outline here. Said, and I put down, in the history of the church, many spiritual gifts have been used and abused to the detriment of the church. And again, I get back to what I told you earlier. All dreams and visions need to be measured by the Bible. A study of dreams and visions in Acts show. Listen, dreams and visions have the idea that they're to be used. They'd be used by that person to witness. Anytime any of those things come up, they're to be used as a witness. They're not to be used for self-edification. It's just like the gifts of the Spirit. The gifts of the Spirit. Like we talk about tongues and the healing. But any of the gifts that you have is not to bring glory to you. It's to be to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ. It's to show the power of God in your life. So when I see that here, he says here, it's not to be personal edification or to make me look smarter or more spiritual than somebody else. We have that tendency sometimes to kind of push ourselves up. And we forget the purpose, the cause. See, we're reading right here in the book of Acts, and we're seeing the formation of the first church. We're going to have the first message. But all of that, it's not that Peter's not up there to say, look at me. Peter's saying, I got something I want to tell you. And that's what for you and I. So when we talk about prophesying here, we're talking about going out there. It says for all of them. What did he say right there? He said, I will, on my servants and on my handmaids, I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. Everybody has that responsibility. Everybody has that responsibility to take that message out. That's what he's going to preach and proclaim here, and we're going to see how it affected people. When you preach and teach the Word of God, when you touch people with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit gets hold of them, they're going to humble themselves, they're going to turn and put their faith and trust in Christ. So that's what we're seeing here. We're seeing the birth of the church. We're seeing the idea that this work can be done now. And so when we get saved, and when he talks about his spirit, he says, I will pour out in those days my spirit. The spirit doesn't come until you get saved. It's not out there for everybody. All those men that were hearing all this in their own ears, in their own language, a lot of them were mocking. They were rejecting. They didn't get the Spirit. But in those last days, as we see the prophecy of Joel, the last days when a person, a man or a woman, or whoever gets saved, a child, old child, young child, whatever, when a person gets saved, they receive the Spirit. And then all these things can happen. And then they can prophesy. Then they can teach. But it doesn't happen until you're born again. You must be born of the Spirit to have these things happen. And we're seeing that here. We're going to see that idea of that Spirit coming. Prophecy is given to everybody. Because we have the message to give. See, it's not just a preacher, it's not just a deacon. Everybody needs to be sharing the gospel with Jesus Christ. In fact, a lot of times people will be have a greater tendency to listen to someone that's not an authority figure in the church. Somebody they just work with. Somebody they just go to school with. Because they have a greater trust for them. Sometimes people get the idea that you're just trying to get a notch in your belt or whatever. I've heard that term used. No, that's not what we're trying to do, but when we share from our heart, listen, from our heart, we have a message for the world that's unique. It's one of a kind. Our message is that man is a sinner, but God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son that whosoever believeth in him, whosoever will put their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and his shed blood will have eternal life. That's our message. Nobody else has that message. And it's not Christ plus anything else. It's that shed blood is sufficient. It is finished from the cross. So when we look at this, and we're going to stop right here. We had a little bit more that we could get with today, but we're going to stop and we'll pick it up again next Wednesday in verse 19. And then we'll get into his message. But for right now, I just want you to stay focused on what is our purpose? What is he trying to teach us? What is he trying to teach us as we read and study this? And he's teaching us right now. He's saying, you know what? That you need to be sharing the gospel. Everybody. He poured out his Spirit on all of us, all of his children, for the purpose of being a witness. And that's what these people are doing right here. As Peter gets up and as these men and women go out into the world, they're witnessing what they have seen, what they've had a part in, and they're telling the world. And that's what we need to be doing, sharing the gospel, the good news. Okay, so next week we'll pick up verse 19 and we'll continue our study here in the book of Acts. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day and for this time. And we just pray you be with us today as we go our way, that you'd give us wisdom and discernment in dealing with our own lives, Lord, and the way we live our life and our testimony. We pray we'd be found faithful to tell others the good news that Christ has paid the price for their sins, that through faith and trust in him, they have eternal life. So be with each one of us, Lord. Help us to be a blessing to you and a blessing to others. And for those that don't know Christ, we pray this would be the day, that this would be the time that they'd come to know Jesus. And we'll thank and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.